Okay, good morning everyone, everybody that made it through the metro. I'm not going to talk a lot about FIBA and basketball this morning. I'm going to talk about media more in a general perspective from the rights holder point of view. But still, in order to get a little bit into the mood of the morning and the emotion of the sport, sorry, I'm not pushing the slides yet, but can you go back? That's where we should be. Thank you. Also, the technology has its wake-up moment, but to wake up in the room, anyway, start with a small video. Okay, now it's tough to stay at that level of emotion over the next 15 minutes, but I'm going to try, but I'm going to talk about the world of media, and specifically in the world of the internet, let's say phase four, when I come to it later, what is content still king? Is it still good news for the sports, and is it good news for the sports rights holders? Now, when I talk about rights holders, I have to ask you to click through, I think, because this doesn't work. Maybe if somebody has one that works, it would be good, because there we go. So rights holders, in summary, what are rights holders? Federations, leagues on a national level, and also, let's say, sports that are maybe in the next generation. May I ask in the room here, how many of you can raise a hand and say, I represent directly or indirectly a rights holder? Okay, and who is representing a media company? Okay, interesting to see. So I hope that specifically for those rights holders, this presentation is going to be interesting, because it's going to speak a little bit about the background, but also trying to give some suggestions what rights holders can do in the world now and the world to come to benefit from the opportunities, but also to protect against certain pitfalls. Because the question is it only good news? And maybe it is not. So, looking at the system, as I said, the rights holders, you see them on the top here on the slide, that, you know, normally reach the fans, the viewers, the clients through the media partners, and then in the middle sometimes there's agencies, intermediaries that broker the deals or facilitate the deals. Now, this is a very generic model, with in the middle, you know, the media partners, which can be channels, which can be platforms, which can be telcos or combinations of these. And of course, in the world today, the Netflix world of today, a lot of you might think, well, why can we not go directly as a rights holder to these viewers? And I come to that later, into what extent that is really an option or not for certain rights holders more than others. Why is sport different? Why is sport unique? Well, sport is different than, you know, movies or music to start with, because the live is what is, you know, the filet steak of it. That's where the most of the value and the interest is in sports. It is also non-replicable. There's only one Roland Garros. There's only one Olympic Games. There's only one Formula One. In that sense, they can also be given on an exclusive basis, granted on an exclusive basis, which is valuable. And similar to music, and more different than entertainment, you know, there are no language barriers in sports in general. So it is easy to transfer around the world through different cultures and different languages. What do rights holders typically look for? They typically look for visibility, and they look for revenues. And, you know, in a nice way, when we were selling properties on behalf of a rights holder, we would always use, we would like to maximize the visibility and optimize the revenues. But in certain realities, in certain sports leagues, that can be the other way around. But this is, of course, a very, you know, simplistic view. And it's also something that you need to see in the perspective of something more comprehensive and a little bit longer term. Because, of course, the visibility also leads to, has a connection with sponsorship, for instance, which leads to revenues. And also, exposure is important because you need to look at the longer run. What I mean with that is that many sports organizers can be tempted by taking the money and taking the money now, and thereby sometimes putting their sport behind the paywall or in the environment of a very limited viewership, whereby over time the sport disappears. I'll also come back to the value of free TV today in the mix of exposure, especially as we have also a representative from Facebook here today who might have a different view on that model where we are today than 10 years ago. Anyway, how did it develop over the years? I mean, I'll take you a very quick journey on the media landscape. Phase number one, we talk about the 70s, the 80s, and I'm talking now here about the French reality in particular. The world was very simple. You were sitting at home, you had two channels to choose from, maybe three. I don't know if you had France, you know, deux, trois at the time. And this is not only in France, this is across Europe in particular, the way it was. You had two, three channels per country. You had an organization called the EBU that would gather these public broadcasters, and if you could get some visibility for your sport, it was there. Then normally in the 80s, early 90s, you got private television. So you got private broadcasters that, you know, became in and, you know, generated a little bit of competition. So you had the TF1s in France, but you had the media sets in Italy, you had Channel 4 in the UK, RTL Group in Germany, and so on and so forth. So that was bringing a little bit more options and competition for the sport. The real competition came in the early 90s. The real competition started with pay TV. And pay TV saw that sport was the battering ram, as Rupert Murdoch called it at the time, to really drive their subscription base up. So in France, you know, Canal Plus, as one of the leaders in Europe at the start, with, you know, a lot of subscribers already in the initial phase. Again, Sky, Premiere in Germany, Telepiu in Italy, all these players came on board and were also then joined in that phase by certain telcos that came in, the BTs, SFR in France quite recently and quite aggressively, and also some competitors in certain market, as you see here. So this was phase three. Phase number four, where we are already in since a while now, is the the non-linear world. So the world, the internet world, which already since quite a while gives options on, you know, platforms like YouTube, Facebook, Amazon Prime, and you see more and more people also looking for this Netflix of sports. You know, people from Germany, Austria, Switzerland have already seen the Zone being launched by the Perform Group, as well as people in Japan. But there is more of this type of development coming, and is on the way. So, you know, as I said, phase two and three were, especially the phase three, the pay TV, were golden moments for rights holders, you know, especially for certain types of rights holders. More choice, more competition, more revenues, more options. And that's also important to know, these operators like Canal Plus, like beIN, they would, like Sky, they would make these packages, these bundles, these quite expensive bundles, whereby at the end of the day, people would pay 50, 60, 70 euros, pounds, or whatever it is per month to subscribe to these platforms. Now, where are we? You would say phase number four, even more options, even more money, even better times. Maybe, maybe not. More players could be more value. But the question is also what's happening, who are the real entrants? Is Amazon really gonna get into the market? Is Facebook, you can ask them after, it's gonna, you know, proceed into the world of sports even more. Is it good news? Is this disrupting the market? Is it, you know, maybe also having effects like there have been on the music industry, as you know, at a certain time when, you know, initially there was a big correction in the market. So, for that to answer, or to try and give an answer, you must also think what happens in this so-called phase four. Well, one is obvious, unlimited content, thousands of hours, of outlets, of channels, of options that are there. Secondly, you see a lot more short-form content. And you see that, you know, on your mobile devices, you see that, you know, with us here in the room, and you probably see it even much more with your children or your younger family members that are consuming media and sports. Also a lot of user-generated content which is coming on top of that, which is very popular. Thirdly, unbundling of packages. You see, without going into detail, you see that there is this cord cutting going on with, you know, ESPN in the USA. There you see that a lot of these big bundled operators are suffering to keep on people to pay those 50, 60, 70 euros per month. People want to be more flexible. People don't want to pay a lot of money for something they don't consume. So that trend is happening already now. More accountability. That's an important one also for rights holders in the room, because in the old days, when you were part of a bundle, it wasn't that transparent how many people really were watching your sport. Now, with the OTT solutions, these people know exactly who's watching what sport, how long. And be careful, because that can be good news in some cases, but it can also be terrible news for others, because it shows the reality. It shows that certain properties, maybe with big names that used to receive big checks, are not delivering the value. That's also related to number five, to the next point. This is a non-linear world, so you don't have any more 10 sports channels from 8 in the morning until 4, you know, until midnight that need to be filled. They don't need to fill channels. There's content when the content is live. You know, you offer it. You don't need, I don't want to offend anybody, but in a football, you don't need the Belgian and Portuguese football league in the afternoon just to fill the schedule. It's not necessary at that time. There's no, you know, it's just there what people watch and when it's live. The second screen becoming the first screen, a bit of an obvious one, but you see it yourself, I think, also. I mean, still these operators all try to push you to the big screen, but I think a lot of it you watching on the go and even at home on your iPad, on your iPhone and other devices. you have a high reach as a sports rights holder. It's great. You can target a lot of people. There's a lot of platforms, but there's an enormous amount of fragmentation. So it's also quite complicated to make sure you reach through those options. And as a last point, of course, we all talk now about, you know, the mobile devices. We talk about the YouTubes, the Facebooks, etc., etc. There's still a big part of this world which is very traditional, laid back, remote control, sitting at home with the beer and watching the games. That's still a big audience. Maybe not all the young people, but it's still very substantial. In terms of a rights fee driver, it's still very important for the sports. So what are the opportunities now for rights holders? The opportunities come from, it's, you know, you see an enormous decline in production and distribution costs. It's much easier to get and much cheaper to get a decent production and make that available in terms of live production, in terms of clips. I mean, all these tools, technologies that are there make it possible, you know, to be, you know to be sustainable with a much smaller audience. So the properties in the long tail, as they say, the smaller properties, the niche properties, have a lot of opportunities, and I'll come to that later on. Secondly, of course, you have a direct relationship in many cases through some with your you know, with your people and access to data. You have a much better understanding who are the people that follow you, but you also have a much better understanding what works and what doesn't work. That's the beauty of, you know, of digital media. I mean, when we do something with FIBA on Facebook or Twitter, we know immediately which content worked and which not. So, you know, next time around, we know which mechanisms and which formats work. There's an opportunity to have more outlets, more partnerships, and if you know, segment your rights correctly, you can really benefit from that. It's very, very relevant to stay in touch with the next generations. I mean, we're just talking before that free TV makes still a lot of audiences, but on public television in a country which I will not name, cycling, which is a fantastic sport, on the public broadcaster, makes millions of audiences, but the average age of the viewer, and don't be shocked, the average age of the viewer is 61 years old. Average. So for one 20-year-old kid watching cycling, there's 3 80-year-old men in the rooms. So if you want to stay in touch with that younger audience, they're not watching the afternoon on Sunday, the whole afternoon, Paris-Roubaix, okay, something I love, but I'm not that generation. Direct-to-consumer opportunities for certain rights holders. We said a lot of people think, wow, I can, you know, I can now go direct. I can have fishing.tv, I can have basketball.tv, and I can do curling.tv, and I can go direct. I don't need the broadcasters anymore. Well, be careful. And we also speak from experience. I mean, you take in the world of basketball, you know, the NBA League Pass, great product, and works very well in most markets where there's an opportunity. But we have our own live basketball TV, which also works in certain markets, but we know exactly what is possible and what is not. So don't just think, I can go directly, I can cut out these broadcasters and I can do that. Why not? Why do you still need aggregators? Maybe they're not broadcasters. Maybe your aggregator is somebody else here in the room. But you still need the know-how of a broadcast group or a media group. You still need critical mass, because you still need, you know, a certain element of audience, which comes together with promotion, which also comes together with a brand name. I mean, people know ESPN, people know Canal Plus, people know Eurosport. So the aggregator is still very valuable. And from a rights holder point of view, let's be honest, also the financial certainty plays a big role. You would like to know at the start of a cycle what you can expect, ideally. And, you know, to become a D2C is very entrepreneurial, but that also means very limited security
if you do it in a certain way.
So what are the dilemmas for rights holders? The dilemmas, it's still, you know, do I take the money, do I take the exposure, in simple terms? That is still there. It's still, in that context, the demands for exclusivity, because many that say, I want, you know, to give you a certain check, they say, then I also want the exclusivity. And sometimes they ask more exclusivity than they really want, just from a defensive point of view. If you look at exposure, of course you have to say, what is my target audience? What kind of revenues can I get from social media? And that will be, you know, a question for Facebook later on. I mean, how can we all benefit? You know, as we have seen, we have made experience with YouTube, fantastic results in terms of visibility. But when the check came at the end of the month, you thought there were was at least one zero missing. But that was not the truth. And as the last one, we're still in this two-world society, so you still need to cater for the man, the woman with the remote control, as well as those with the device. So the question is this still the paradigm for the future? Is it still free TV bringing you the exposure and pay TV bringing you the revenues, or to make it more provocatively, in the presence also of let's say Facebook in the room, is Facebook the new free TV? Is, you know, France Télévision, is that still the holy grail for visibility? Is that still where you reach most people and a certain target audience? Or maybe not, you know? As I say, maybe those platforms are, you know, where you get most eyeballs. Winners and losers. Very difficult to say from the rights holders that around who are, you know, the winners and losers in this new phase. I mean, more generically, you can probably say the people that are at the top of the tree, the FIFA World Cups, the Premier League, the Champions League, the Formula One people, they're probably anyway, you know, the must-have flagship properties, they will be good, because they also in that world are going to be the ones that the new entrants need to drive, and they will pay a premium for that. Probably the niche sports are the ones that have, with reduced production and distribution costs, have a good opportunity, and in certain markets. I mean, NFL football in Europe, I mean, how big is it? But NFL football, for instance, has quite a strong following in Germany. There is quite a niche of people that really want to follow NFL. So that niche, relatively speaking, is willing to pay good money to watch NFL. So that is an example. Maybe cricket in the US, or, you know, there are certain sports that have that opportunity more than before. I think in general, people that are going to struggle are the ones that, let's say, the program fillers that are stuck in the middle and, you know, are neither top nor niche. Trying to give advice, coming to an end. And this is the difficult part. Try to keep control, not just take the money. Invest in your product, not only harvest. That's very difficult for a rights holder, because people are very happy to take the money from a rights holder rather than to say, I reinvest in my own product and properties, but it's super important. Build up stars in your sport. In basketball, we're very privileged because we have stars. We have a lot of stars. In the ranking of the Forbes 100 athletes, 20 NBA players. So we are lucky. I mean, you take other great sports. In France, handball is great. You have stars in France, but globally, there's not so many handball stars. Volleyball is very widely distributed, has no stars. But the stars is important to build up, because stars are important, especially in that new world where you deal with a young audience, with these millennials, and where you want to be on these platforms. You need to have the stars. In that context, use social media, develop new formats, and look also at developments. I mean, buzzword e-gaming. We'll not talk too much about that, but that is a topic on its own. Keep your shop window. So, you know, go maybe more on OTT or niches on pay TV, but make sure your sport is still visible. and attract also an audience beyond the hardcore. So to come back to the NFL example, it's great if the NFL has all these NFL fans and freaks watching them on an OTT platform, but you still need to make sure you get visible also for the people that are not yet in that group. So a lot of advice, I'm coming to an end, the clock is ticking, but the last piece of advice, which is the most important one actually, is have a plan, think about it. Because as they say, winners have a plan, losers have an excuse. If you don't have a, if you have a plan, it might go wrong. But if you don't have a plan, it will certainly go wrong. So that's it. Thank you very much.